University, and I've been asked to preside the jury today. I'm assisted by Antonio Berger from this university, who's our secretary, and by Dr. Pep Forrest, who's the vocal from the University of Girona. We're here today to look at the defense of Miguel Francisco Massot Campos, whose thesis is entitled New Insight on Laser-Based Structured Life for Underwater 3D Reconstruction. So the process is as follows. We're going to have a presentation of the work by Miguel for about an hour, and that will be followed by questions, and then we'll open the floor to some of you. So without further ado, Miguel, will you present us your work?
Thank you very much. So as you said, I'm going to present new insights on the laser-based structured light for underwater 3D reconstruction. First of all, I'm going to show you some motivation behind. So our knowledge on ocean exploration is very limited. So far, we know more about Mars than we know from other oceans, which are just in front of us. So if you look at the numbers, Mars has been explored using satellites at a resolution of 20 meters from space, which takes into account objects the size of a tennis pitch. Whereas in the ocean, if you look at the numbers according to the states, according to NOAA, less than 15% of the ocean has been explored at less than 100 meters resolution. So that's hardly no knowledge at all. And the reason behind is that the oceans are really harsh environment. They are difficult to access and they are very costly. So the images on the right show you the challenges you can find in the ocean when you are on a ship. So rough seas and limited accessibility. So the next key factor in ocean exploration using underwater cameras, using imaging, are the challenges in the medium. So the underwater domain poses two main challenges, which are absorption and scattering, and there's a limited effort we can do on them. So absorption limits the power in light delivered into the media, and scattering are particles that flow in the water, like marine snow, that limit our visibility. There are some benefits, there are some things we can do that will benefit us, such as laser or less broad light to input more 3D or more light to the oceans. And finally, there's another issue that even if we've got really nice sensors, even if we've got really accurate measurements, our navigation hasn't really matched up our measurements. That is to do with how much we know where our robot or where our sensor is. So if we take, for example, an underwater platform, which is the one shown in the image, which is an upward-looking ADCP that is located in High Beach in the States, if we make two passes over this structure with a laser-based system, and we lay the two reconstructions on top of each other, we see that magically we have two structures instead of one. And that has to do with the uncertainty, with the little knowledge we've got in our underwater positioning. So some efforts have to be taken into better localizing our underwater robots. So reasons being that depth recon increases with time, and we have increased our sensor resolution, but we have increased our position. So the goal of the thesis, all of this work, is to progress towards the definition of methods to consistently reconstruct underwater environments in 3D, even in featureless regions. And summarizing three bullet points, first thing to do is to better understand how we reconstruct the underwater environment and which methods and sensors have been developed so far. Then do some research on featureless reconstructions, so how to reconstruct in 3D objects and terrains that have no texture or no easy way of picturing them with common imaging systems, and how to achieve cell consistency on the water maps to avoid artifacts such as the one presented before. So therefore, the thesis of this presentation has been structured in the following ways. So first of all, I'm going to show state-of-the-art of the underwater 3D mapping systems that are available. Then I'm going to set the basis of a laser-based structured light sensor and the framework to perform 3D reconstruction. Once we've got all the toolkit to perform 3D and then my mind to progress towards self-consistency, presenting two methods or two solutions in bathymetric slam. One being somehow slam, and the second one being bathymetric funding of the slam. Then summarize and present some conclusions, and then how did we get there with all these methods and sensors. So that's the first thing in state of the art. I'm looking forward in categorizing all the methods and sensors that are available in algorithm domain, and they are mainly three different methods to perform depth or range measurements. The three are time of flight, modulation, and triangulation. And among these methods, we can find sensors that are more towards one of the methods than others. So for instance, sonar is a time of flight sensor. For instance, laser line scanning, LLS, can have triangulation, time of flight, and modulation options. And the ones that are on the top are stereo vision, structured light, and structured for motion. So I'm going to explain each one of these and give some examples to know what is available currently. So time of flight sensors work by computing the delta t, the difference in time between the time when we send an echo, for instance, in sonar, and we receive back this echo from the seafloor, and by knowing the speed of sound on the water, we can compute the range. And the sensors that use this method are the set sonar, LiDAR uses light in set, and pulsated laser line scanning uses time of flight in this as well. Modulation method work by looking at the phase difference between a modulated signal. So there's been little work in this area, mainly the author that is going pushing science forward has been Linda Wooden, and showing you one figure for her, where she was combing or modulating light, laser light, with a microwave source, and then looking at the phase difference between the incoming and outgoing light beam. The sensors that use modulation methods are sonar, the most famous one is the chirp modulation, we have LiDAR sensors, and we also have some modulated laser light scanning solutions. And finally, triangulation, which is the basis of this thesis, is essentially using geometrics, pure geometric relationships between a source or an emitter and a receiver or a camera, for instance, to triangulate positionings in the 3D domain. So sensors using this method are many, mainly four of them. Photometric stereo uses, for instance, different sources of light to compute positions of each point. Then we can find structured light that uses different patterns, normally using a projector, can be in color, can be in black and white, to compute 3D. And we finally find the structured for motion of photogrammetry and a stereoscopy, who essentially use features, 3D features or image features in space to compute 3D points. So some examples of them are summarized in the following table. So for time of flight and modulation, we can find people who have shown applications of these sensors. So for instance, Kafar has shown reconstruction of a bridge in a river, and they accounted for accuracy of 1 meter and 100 meter range. Or Tosco Fienza Lee presented matching between multi-beam and a camera to perform texture mapping points. Guo showed a toy example of vessel with a single beam sonar to make 3D reconstructions as well. And in SciScan sonar, I'm presenting a method from Coilas and Petit, where they were detecting underwater pipes at the resolution of 19 centimeters, about from 100 meters. In pulsated laser line scanning, we found the work from Andrea and Jacobson, which are the fathers of 2G robotics, that show really nice underwater structure mapped at 8 meters with a resolution of 5, or accuracy of 5 millimeters. Imaki et al. From the University of Tokyo, they developed pulsated laser light scanning as well, and they were showing transects with a standard deviation of 2 centimeters, of 20 meters range. Then Mullen, that's the lady they showed before, with population laser light scanning, they could get 10 centimeters. perceive. We found words from Canali, from the Navy, detecting underwater mines using LiDAR from airplanes, and from airplanes as well, we found some maps of, the meter below seawater in one of the states. That's for time of flight and regulation. Then I'm showing some results on triangulation, some studies of them. So we have found examples of structural formation from Oscar Pizarro, Epstein's and Sine, and they accounted for 3 centimeters accuracy. Bruno, by looking at differences in growth in coral reefs by comparing different fluid reconstruction of the water. Inglis and Romain show comparisons between stereo vision and multi-beam. However, they don't provide accuracy measurements, but I found that it was a very nice ground truth for them. Beal did something similar with structured vision, and then we move forward into structured light. In structured light, there has been little examples in the water. One of them is on the master thesis of Tomlo, who has shown projections of a common structured light system, and they had an accuracy of 2 millimeters. However, for these systems, you require to have a scene that is completely static. If the object was baffled by moving, the solution would be impossible. Bruno showed this in our example. Madison Hunt show, instead of a laser plane, show a plane of light with similar results. Bodenman and Horton show an example of laser lines on a laser line on the water. Half of the image lit, half of the image in shadow to have 3D and textual information. And then finally, the most recent examples from Palomar in the University of Girona, who has developed motorized laser line scanning. And the example I'm showing in this PDG, which is a one shot field reconstruction. So, from all these different authors and methods, we see a trend in how range and resolution are related to. So we have found that sonar, for instance, covers a large number of ranges, but with a limited resolution, and then if we need to push forward, then we need to change methods. So anything, any sensor or any method that pushes this boundary forward, we could call it the same effects and improve sensing and it's pushing the state of the art. And by looking at all these bibliography, we have identified two gaps in the literature, one of them being that there's a lack of one-shot methods, one-shot solutions, and then another gap is that there is self-consistency has not been addressed. And therefore, the proposed contributions of this PhD are firstly a one-shot laser-based structured light solution with the decoding method, and secondly, to address self-consistency, we propose two Latin exam solutions, Grassland and augmented state value. So then I'm going to start by showing you the framework of a laser-based structured light system using a laser plane defined by this light plane, by n, that originates from a point in space. And there's a second element in the sensor, which is a camera with a focal point. And its image frame, and then we use triangulation, which is essentially finding the intersection between the line that joins the detected laser point in the image to the laser plane in space. By finding this intersection, we find the point in the wall in 3D coordinates. So the framework for a multi-shot single line approach is commonly used in laser scanning. It's firstly to detect the laser in the image, that would be to find U and V coordinates, then to triangulate this point in space, to find this point P in 3D world, and composite, and doing composition of these different points in with the platform as the platform is moving. And finally, we will need to perform a calibration beforehand to know which is the laser plane, otherwise we don't know which point works. And then representing as well what are the changes in regards to performing, instead of a multi-shot single line, performing a one-shot multi-line approach. And we will change the steps, and we will do a segmentation and encoding, and then the same triangulation, convolution, conversion. So, in terms of laser detection, our input images are mostly black, with a faint laser line. I don't know if you can see it from there, but there's a line just more or less where I'm pointing. If you will see, I'm providing you a cross cut of this laser, and we can see the value of intensity in each pixel, and we see a long peak where this laser line is. And from there, we run three different steps. Firstly, there's a demo making step. In case the camera is a color camera, if the camera was a monochrome camera, we would omit this step. If it is a color camera is a layer pattern in front, and we have to be smart about it. So for that, we will give different weights at each different channel to match up with the laser color. So say, if we have a green laser, we will give more weight to the green channel than the other channels. Then, once we've got a laser image, then we will use an integral method, lighting window, to find the maximum integral value for each row. And once we have found the maximum value for each row, we run a sub-pixel detection algorithm based in a Gaussian approximation. And that will give us, for each row, the coordinates of where the peak was located. And that's the UV point in pixel coordinates that we use for performing the triangulation. The triangulation step follows us. Given a laser plane where we know the coordinates, we intersect this plane with a line whose coordinates depend on the pixel coordinates of the laser, U and V, and the camera calibration, which is not covered in this presentation, but is essentially a pinpoint camera model. And then by defining the intersection, we find a single point, and by repeating this per row, we can define a point cloud. Once we've got the point cloud for each camera frame, we can make a composition of them by transforming their coordinates. So we will have a point cloud in the if frame. We'll make a composition for a transformation of it from the camera frame to the robot frame, and then using that reckoning for other validation solutions, such as EKF, so extended camera filters, particle filters, we will change the coordinates from the robot if frame for each position to the wall. And this is, for instance, an example of a 3D reconstruction of data from the hardware groups where I participated. And finally, to make all this work, we need to have a good calibration. We need to know where the laser plane is with respect to the camera. And for that, I am presenting two different methods for calibration. The first one is the very naive one, where we use the same approach to calibrate a camera, and we use it to calibrate the laser. And that requires an ideal lighting scene where we can detect both the calibration plane and the laser line. The first step is to detect the chessboard plane using common tools for camera calibration that will give us the plane coordinates of the chessboard, and we need to project the laser line into the same plane. Therefore, we know beforehand what is the plane the laser is intersecting into, and we can find the 3D coordinates of it. And we do this multiple times at different depths to find 3D points of the laser. And finally, we fit the plane using Balearic. Balearic is an iterative method to find the best option and to remove bias. A second option to make laser calibration is to make good use of the dying phase of an AB. So for instance, this method has been used on the platform AE2000F, which is the same AB that did the Falcon Cruise. And the characteristics of this AB is a two-propeller AB and has to use fins to maintain its altitude. So therefore, for the AB to dive, needs to follow a helix pattern to gain depth. So we use this helix pattern to project the laser line at different heights, at different altitudes, and we use a stereo camera system that was available at the time, so we required a stereo camera. We use that stereo with ourselves a toolkit to perform 3D reconstruction using laser, and then we're going to build on the new steps of segmentation and decoding for a one-shot application. So the one-shot superlight sensor that I am presenting is formed with the same elements, with a camera and a laser. There's an element in between the same, which is this diffractive optical element, which is like a lens and a filter you put in front of the laser, and that turns a laser point into a set of parallel lines. The framework that I'm going to present can be scalable to any number of lines. The requirement is that the lines are parallel and that there is a bright dot in the center. With the sensor, this would be the images that we can obtain. So the diffractive optical element that it was working with was a 25 parallel line DOE that made our scene look like this. So it's like a square pattern with 25 lines. And from this input image, we need to find which line is which line in index number to be able to triangulate them using the same framework presented before, but with 25 different things. So first I'm going to present the segmentation step to find each laser point in each column or in each row, depending where the pattern is facing. Then a decoding step to find which laser line is which. And finally, the triangulation is the same as before. For the segmentation, our input image without an object, for instance, would look like the one on the left. If we look at a crosscut of this image, that would be the intensities that we find. And if we look at the crosscut where the center dot is, we find that there's a bright dot in the middle. That's one of the requirements of this sensor, at least of the approach I'm presenting, is that the central dot has to be, what I would commonly say, has to be burned. So it has to become, to have maximum value. To be identified. That's easily achieved by just tuning the camera parameters to find the maximum point in the center. So then, the first step to perform segmentation is a red channel subtraction. So we remove the red channel because it contains the background lighting of the image. Then we subtract the output of the media filter, and then we perform a single threshold. The output of the thresholding is the image on the right, which is a binary image, and we can then find the laser points easily. And then for each of these white points, we run the same subpixel algorithm presented before. Once we've got all our peaks, we need to identify which laser line belongs to which laser plane. And for that, I am presenting a method on decoding. And to decode, I'm using a graph approach, and from the graph, I'm running a maximum spanning tree. So first, I define a graph where the nodes of the graph are the groups of pixels, and the edges of the graph are the relationship between these groups of pixels. A group of pixels is defined as those pixels that share one or more corners. So for instance, in this example image, we have group A that has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 pixels. We have group B, C, D, E, and F. We make them as a graph without edges at the moment, like that. Then, I define the edges and the weight of these edges as the number of neighbors each group has. And a neighbor is the number of rows that a group shares with another one without any object in the middle. So for instance, A and C have two pixel neighbors, A and D has 7, and if we move forward, we find that C and B have one neighbor, B, which is down here, and E have the same number of neighbors as E and F, which is 6. And then this graph is then used to find all the paths of maximum weight. That's essentially the maximum spanning tree. And by by doing that, we can, from this example, remove the link between A and C, which has a low wave, and the edge from C and D, which has a low wave, and find all these waves from points. Then, the last node that has no children becomes the last index in the laser indexing. And as we move forward to one of the parents, they belong to one lesser index. So if we say F in this example of 3, F is index number 3, would mean that B, E, and C are index number 2, and D and A are index number 1, which corresponds to the colors in the image. This setup presented here with the recoding and the segmentation were the ones used in the experiments that I will present following. There are three sets of experiments. The first two of them were performed at Heidelberg University in their facilities. I used a camera and a laser enclosed in diving housing. I used a Cartesian robot that allowed me to move these two sensors in X and Y coordinates completely. And I placed the following objects in the pool to perform reconstructions and look at the angle of camera. And there's another set of examples of experiments where I was using a small tank here at the University of the Gardens, where I had the same setup, I had the same camera system and laser system, and I was pouring controlled bowls of milk to increase the turbidity levels and see how turbidity affected the sensor. So first I'm going to present a single object reconstruction experiments, then a comparison to stereo in a survey, and then finally a turbidity example. So in object reconstruction, I was reconstructing the objects presented in the figure before, so a square pipe, a round pipe, a wheel, and a pyramid, and I compared the 3D reconstructions with a stereo camera that I used at the time, which was a Bumblebee 2. And we can see, for instance, for the object that is reconstructed here, which is a round pipe, where its external diameter was 16 centimeters and its length was 75, that the laser could pick up really well the diameter. The length was a little bit higher, and this time we had similarly was a little bit more accurate. For the other sensor, for the other objects were quite similar output. For the comparison in survey, I placed these objects in the pool bottom in different parts of the pool, and I performed a land move pattern of 3 by 2 meters at 47 meters altitude. Made one run with the stereo and another one with the laser rays, the light system presented. So the image on the left that I showed before is just a mosaic of the pool floor. And then two reconstructions on the right, the first one is performed using stereo, and the second one performed using the sensor presented in this thesis. So if we align both point clouds using ICP and compare the point by point, we can find the following map. And to make the comparison fair, we read the both point clouds to 7 millimeters and we compute the error using inverse angles. So from here, we can find that the C, C floor is a full floor, that the round floor is more or less level, and the largest errors were at this square pipe and at the spiral here. So if we look closely, and I align again both point clouds on top of each other, we see that for the square pipe, we find largest errors here, because actually the stereo point cloud was empty. So it was a white pipe, the stereo wasn't able to pick up 3D measurements, but actually the laser system could. So by computing the error metrics in nearest neighbors, obviously for a point here, the nearest neighbor would be one on the edge. That's why you get high values. However, in structures such as the pyramid of this round pipe, we find that actually the point cloud is shattered, and that was a mechanical issue with the carrier of the robot that needed a little bit of time to settle, and it was wobbly. However, nonetheless, we can still use this shattered point cloud histogram of the data shown here, we find that more or less the mean error is at about 3-ish millimeters, and there's a long queue on the right of these errors, like the ones in the square pipe and the ones in the shadow deposits. So, surprisingly, and it's also the top of it, the reconstruction on wheel was very accurate, and the reconstruction on the pipe was very accurate as well. And finally, the third example is the turbidity one, which, as we commented before, arguably mimicked with milk. We used a small water tank, and we were pouring different concentrations of milk to see how the system behaved. So I'm presenting on the table on the right 9 different experiments. I'm not showing all the images, I'm showing them in 3 steps. So for instance, the image on the far left is the starting condition, so water was clean. And we find here an American jar and a white bottle on top of a, shelf. And we can find the 3D reconstruction of these objects really well. We can pick up the pieces. As we increase turbidity levels by increasing the number of milliliters of milk poured into this tank, we see how the number of 3D points changes with concentration. So at the beginning, we were able to reconstruct 13,000 points. By the experiment, for instance, number 7, with 30 milliliters of milk, we are still able to reconstruct 9,800, which is the experiment shown here. As you can see, that the point cloud is less dense. And then finally, when we reach the maximum concentration, we lost our time. We can see here that there is mainly no trend. So even if the amount of turbidity increase, the number of 3D points is more or less constant. So if you think from the point of view of a camera, when we need a flow pipe to see what is in front of us, by increasing a little bit our turbidity levels, our absorption and our scattering will become quite noticeable, and we would barely see our scene. So in summary, from these experiments, you can see that in the signal object error analysis, we find that the laser-based circuit light has a mean error of 2.2 centimeters with a standard deviation of about 3. And stereoscopy has almost half of that. You can see the same results in the figure on the right. However, we can recover featureless objects, such as the square pipe presented. We had some pitching issues due to the bolt system on a long bolt. And in turbidity, we found that the recovered shape was not affected by the amount of turbidity. So, some remarks of this sensor. We can see that there's a trade-off between color and shape. So if we want to obtain color, obviously, the sensor presented is not the best option, but it's useful to have shape and provides a sparse 3D cloud instantly. We find it useful for close-up applications, such as manipulation docking or dynamic environments. It's probably not the best choice for a long survey, given its narrow field of view. So, as an alternative, and to have a better scalability, we propose having multi-shot single line, which is a more naive approach, and we need to address such consistency, as we saw before. So for that reason, we conducted some research in bathymetric slamming. In bathymetric slamming, I'm going to present you 2 methods, but first of all, we need to look at how underwater navigation is treated. So when we are underwater, we mainly rely on our depth recording sensors, which is usually a DVL, IMU, and pressure sensor. The use of 3 is normally important to depth recording, which is the knowledge of the platform on where it is itself. This depth recording has normally an error of 5% of the distance traveled, which means that when you have a platform underwater for a long time, it no longer knows where the platform is. So to bound that, we can use carbon filters, we can use particle filters, or we can use the SLAM approaches. In the SLAM approaches, we have 2 options. One is to have a visual SLAM using visual features, using cameras, and another more approach would be to use feature as a SLAM, which is the one approach to this PC. The problem problems on features lab that we find is that the features change depending on the point of view, and that we can find featureless arrays such as sand or mud. In featureless lab, there are many approaches. The ones presented here are grid-based and submap-based, but there are others, such as Gaussian processes or Hilbert maps. The two methods presented are submap and particle grid based. First one, submap slam, is based on the work of Roman and Sain in 2007, and is based in making submaps, little groups of point clouds, storing them in a graph, and then finding loop closures with these small graphs. And the other solution that we present here is a grid map approach using particle filter based on the work of Barbie et al. In 2011, and is a brown vacuolized particle filter. In submap RAM, these are the main steps of it. So first we use our 3D laser line, our AV navigation, shown in the previous chapters, to build submaps and compose them. We start as a submap, and we we'll explain exactly. So we start creating submaps, these little pieces of fluid reconstructions, and we store them in the database. And in parallel, we find potential matches, and we add these matches to the database. So the steps are, we need to create some maps, we need to match them, and to match them we propose to use a generalized ICP approach that uses point-to-point and point-to-plane metrics, and then a graph sum approach using a G2O1 framework. The key differences with the first approach of Roman and Sain, that previously was presented for multibeam, the sum map matching was performed using ACP and used an EKFC augmentation. To generate the submaps, we just compose the submaps with navigation, and we size them given two conditions. One condition is the limit size of the submaps, and the other limit is the uncertainty in navigation. These two parameters highly depend on each platform and its survey. So for instance, for Sparrow 2, we limit them at 3 meters and the uncertainty to 8 centimeters. To perform a candidate search, to perform a submap match, we need to find the nearest sum map at each sum map closure and to see if they overlap or not. If they overlap, we can trigger registration using generalized ICP, and the resulting transformation, if it is successful, it is added to the graph lamp as an image. The assumptions of this registration is that the transformation will be global, so it will be the same for every point, so we are not correcting points inside the sum map, and that it has 60 degrees of freedom. It's completely unbounded. So it can rotate and translate it in any direction. And finally, once we have our graph, we can perform a minimization. The graph is formed by nodes that hold a sum map relative to a robot pose and are represented by 60 degrees of freedom. It's our X, Y, Z coordinates and U. And the edges hold a relative transformation, or that can be either a navigation measurement or can be a loop closure constraint. The minimization performed in the graph lab is based in G2O, so more like 2011, and it's essentially a minimization function of the error and the information matrix. And the error is expressed as the difference between the Z measurement and the Z estimated depth. Information matrix is the uncertainty matrix inverse. So the limitations of this approach, as I said before, is that some maps are inherently not corrected. So if we have inconsistencies within the sum map, we don't correct for those. So the global set consistency is limited and is very dependent on parameters. So that's why we propose as a second option to use particle slam to account for its individual line and to have a framework for value improvement. So, particle filter slam, or P is the mathematical particle filter slam, is built on top of a particle filter where each particle shares a map and shares depth measurements. particle field code, let's give a framework, has four key steps. It has an initialization, where we initialize each particle individually to a known position. We propagate the particles forwards using the motion model, and we measure what does the particle see at its position. Given the measurement from the particle and the real measurement, we can then resample the particle, we can then see how they behave and give large weights to the particles that agree more with the measurements and remove the particles that don't. On top of the particle filter, we are using a raw parabolized particle filter that is essentially a marginalization of the F. So, yeah, I said before, we are using particles and we are building maps. If we were to store a map in every particle, that would become quickly unbearable. So for that, we split our state vector into the following way. We split the localization into an EKF, such as velocities, orientations, accelerations, from the XY localization and orientation that is stored in the particle filter. So that's what the equation on the bottom explains. So the posterior of our position and our map, depending on the measurements and our input, can be split into the posterior of the position that depends only on the measurements and our inputs from our map and our other variables. Graphically, that is represented as. So you have posterior that is really difficult to model as it is. Maybe we can, not really difficult to model, but maybe we can approximate some of the states as Gaussian and treat remaining as a PF. So, given this raw virtualization, we have in the particle with the state vector the XY position and the orientation, and the EKF, which is shared among all particles, stores all the remaining bits, such as raw and pitch, velocities, and accelerations. And the framework of this design is as follows. So we have a quick map shown here as a particle. We have a group particle or a group leaf code that has its own representation in an ancestry tree as a particle 0, for instance. And then from this origin particle, we initialize a number of particles which I represent as vehicles here that move in different points in space. And we keep track of what these particles measure and see in a shared map. And we keep track as well on where do these particles belong. So by propagating forward motion, we start building our own maps with different measurements belonging to different particles. So at this stage, we would be propagating and not resampling. Then, when it comes to a loop closure, so when we revisit the terrain that we have already seen, that's when we can check which particles have better out of the others, and for that we look at how well do they agree in terms of set measurement. So for that we look at the example. For instance, this green vehicle had a sharp turn, and looking at how its prior measurements were and its current measurements were, we can see that it actually agreed quite well, so that would become a good match, whereas for the blue vehicle had a larger turn and find itself in another position in the map, and actually at that point the measurements didn't match, and therefore this particle should be eliminated from the particle filter. So the resampling step would take this particle 1 off and would duplicate this particle 3 and continue forward. So from the map we would remove all measurements made by particle 1, we would keep the map as it is, and we'll be building on top more layers. So when it comes to the end, and we finish our data set, we would retreat the best particle and transverse this graph upwards to find all our measurements. I'm presenting the way of assessing how well they behave. And for that, I'm using a metric proposed by Roman and Sai in 2007, which is called the consistency-based error evaluation, or CEE. And that consists in binning or breeding our 3D maps in X and Z and Y and Z, and looking at the maximum error per bin of the different maps. So for instance, we find here three maps, in X, Z coordinates, and to look on how well they agree or how they disagree, we compute for each bin the maximum error shown in all blue. Using these two approaches, and using this consistency-based error evaluation, I'm presenting two data sets that we gathered in this PC. The first one was gathered using Sparrows tool here at the University of Aragones in Vallehermosa. Sparrows is a 50 kilo 1.6 torpedo, rate of 400 meters, that was mounting one part blue laser that was landed for the University of Tokyo. We performed a survey in Vallehermosa Beach, in Mallorca, and it was 25 by 50 meters at 0.4 knots, 1.5 meters altitude. The second survey we present here was performed with AE2000F, the same vehicle I showed before, the Hennig's pattern for calibration. This vehicle is 370 kilo, 3 meter torpedo shape, 2K rated. It was used during Fatwa Cruise, which I participated in Oregon, in the States, and it made a 350 by 150 meters survey, up to knots and 8 meters of altitude. So from the first survey, we have Mosa. At the top, I am presenting the 3D reconstruction in meters. We have northings and eastings, and Z in color, and the images on the bottom are the error in meters as well, and all four images, all four graphs have the same scale. So if we find deep blue areas, that means there's a very little error. If we find very yellow areas, means a high error. And in columns, we find the tetra point solution, which was really underperforming. We find an ETF and an ETS, that's another smoothing step after an ETF filtering. Then the solution of Sapphire Slam and the solution of the DT Slam, the particle Slam. So here we can see that actually the tracks are completely different. As I said before, the tetra point was really underperforming and there's very little overlap. And in terms of how these two agree, we can see in the following figures. If we look at the error histogram, we found that that Sapphire Slam and PF Slam have an error each of 17.5 centimeters and 13.5 centimeters, which is also summarized in this table. So if we look at the consistency-based error evaluation, in the mean and the standard deviation in meters shown here. If we look at this table, we might notice that the tetra point was actually the best performer, but that is not true because the lines, the tracks, were quite overlapping, and we need overlap for our error metric actually. So if we look at the automobiles, the best performer was actually in this lab with 100 particles. We can see the differences in track here in the graph. We have some of them in green. And for the data set in Hyder Bridge with the 2000, we find the same figures. However, there's no ETF solution as the performing of this platform already accounts for future. So, same approach as before. We look at the error histogram, and I summarize these results in a table afterwards. So, if we look at the consistency-based evaluation again, we find that for this solution, actually the best performer was Sapphire Slam, surprisingly, and DT Slam was limited first at 50 particles, and then if we look at the error, was actually performing worse than that record. Reason being is, as I said before, DT Slam only moves the 3D points in X, Y, and orientation. It doesn't account for Z differences. With 8,000, we were mapping at 80 meters altitude, which means that the triangulation error that we get from this range is quite optimal. And the diagonal tracks that we have in this survey, which were these ones here, were performed at different altitude as the low study, and this resulted in a large error overall. This error was corrected in some subclass because we unbound, we don't bound the transformation. So the subclass were able to be moved in Z as well as in X and Y. So therefore, from this method presented, we can find some advantages and some limitations. The advantages is that both sum approaches have improved self-consistency, that the sum map has solved for 6 degrees of freedom, which at some points can be better, at some points can be worse, whereas if is done just for free, that's how we implement it forever, and if is done can have a better scalability as we could, for instance, have been using maps. The limitation of this system is, or sum mapping is quite clear, so the errors within each sum map are not pressed. The sum map sum solution is parameter intensive, and particle delta sum is also computational intensive when it comes to resampling and accounting for its individual particle map. So, in conclusion, for these thesis, we have seen the following contributions. There's been a thorough iterative review. There's been an in-situ calibration algorithm using step represented, the Elliott one pattern. There's been a one-shot reconstruction and decoding method. And there's been bathymetric slam using this structured line. Furthermore, I want to add that in this PhD, all data sets have been gathered in real environments, with real platforms, with all the challenges that they present. And for future work, I'm currently tutoring a PhD student at the University of Southampton using Gaussian processes for particle delta slam. I want to push forward hybrid mapping solution to balance between stereo vision and laser. And I want to also work towards an auto-calibration method of the laser plane. And finally, there's a common question in bios is how did we get there? So there's a long story behind. I started here with the FBI grant in 2012, which I started in 2013. I participated soon after in a cruise in the Mid-Atlantic Bridge with Javier Scarting. Then I performed next year a stay in Kyrgyzstan with Jean Petitot. Then a couple of years after a stay in Tokyo, which was soon followed by a cruise in the States, that's the SI cruise. Then last year I moved to the UK, I participated in the cruise. And that's so far been translated into being 232 days abroad without counting that year in the road, and of which 82 days at sea. And a lot of ship operations, which is quite different to what we learned from the thesis as well. And in terms of contributions, I have authored several journal articles, of which one is a first author. I've written 20 conferences, of several of which being first author, and one technical reports, and that has to do with this PhD. In terms of teaching, I've been involved in teaching here in the University of Balearic Islands, and as well as Southampton, where I'm teaching currently maritime robotics, and I have participated in a different list of projects and grants, where I'm currently working in the UK, working in Britain. So that's all. Hope you enjoyed, and I'm open to questions.
Thank you very much for this presentation. So we're going to move to the second part of the viva, which is the questions, and I'm going to open the floor to Antonio first for his questions.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, and well, thank you, Miguel, for this excellent presentation. And congratulations to you and to your PhD advisor, because I really think this is a very good work. Not only the presentation, it's very clear, you explain what you have to explain. You did a quite good explanation of particle filters. You also did a very quite good explanation at the beginning of the related work. Really clear, and it is really easy to follow the words on which you are based. But only because of the document is also very well written and structured. I enjoyed the part in which you were able to clearly distinguish between the common parts of the two of the one-shot bathymetric slam and the one-shot digital reconstruction and bathymetric slam. So you clearly divided the information in a, I'd say, proper way. So it is, from my point of view, a very good documentation too. And the most important part, which is the research that is behind your work, I think that it is also really good. I mean, you presented two different studies, two different points of view, the reconstruction and the battlement of Islam. And I think that at some point you can go beyond what is expected for a PhD candidate, because from my point of view, part one, the one-shot study reconstruction is good, but it is not enough to be a PhD thesis, but the second one it is. So if you put the two things together, I say you that you have done even more work than is expected for a PhD student. So again, congratulations. And well, when looking at your publications, I see that I feel somehow reassured about this opinion because, well, you have quite a large amount of publications in conferences. Some of them are good, like some very good, like the IROS, and some other maybe not so good in terms of ranking, but they are very well targeted. You went to AUB and Oceans and these kind of conferences, which are perfect. But when it comes to journals, well, you have 7 journal publications. Yes, there is only one, I think, where you are the first author, and there are, I think, a couple of them that have a lot of authors and so on. But you have 7, and if I'm not wrong, 6 of them are in the first quartile of the journal citation report, and that's really a lot of publications, a lot of quality publications for a PhD candidate. So, again, I think that the research itself is really good, and I think I'm not the only one to believe that because you have this large amount of publications that have been reviewed by external reviewers and so on. So, very good work. I don't really have many criticisms or true questions because, well, on the one hand, for what I have said, but on the other hand, because we have been sharing the same research group for some years, so we more or less know the things that we have been doing. So. Some of the doubts that I can have, I already more or less knew when we are doing research in the same areas. So, would I have a more curiosities? So, maybe you can provide you some answers according to your experience. And the first one is related to something that you say at the very beginning, I think it is in the summary, when you state that your 3D, one-shot 3D reconstruction outperforms plane stereoscopy in featureless scenarios. So there is not a clear quantification in the document about how better is your approach than plane stereoscopy. And do this sentence means that plane stereoscopy, when you have enough text in the environment, is better or not? Because the experiments you provide, I mean, it is not clear which one is better, mainly because I think that you compare your one-shot with your construction with the stereoscopy. So when would you choose each one?
First of all, thank you very much for all the comments. Secondly, it is true. So the sentence states that plane stereoscopy in featureless terrains. Featureless terrains is the keyword. If you have featureless terrain, stereoscopy is not going to pick up any 3D. That's why you can overcome this limitation. However, as I presented, the 3D sensing of stereoscopy when there is texture is actually outperforming the laser resolution system. So I showed that with the results with the because at the beginning, we have to go back to get out. That's actually so if we show here, you see the error in 3D object reconstruction. You actually see that the stereo vision one is half of the one from the supervised perspective. That's also showing numbers. So the mean error for our function laser is actually double of the stereo vision.
Yeah,
that's why I made the comment on there's a trade off whether you want to have color. Shape and whether you are seeing its features or not.
So the 3D, the one-shot 3D reconstruction is good for certain kind of environments, and of course, there is also a question about the how do you, still curiosity, how do you measure the volume, the shape, the size of the objects in the point clouds to do the comparison?
I needed to handpick points
on
feet for the circle.
Sorry, by visual inspection, you decided where the object began and end. And okay, thank you. But you also, that's something that isn't clear, I think, or maybe I haven't understood it. You mentioned that the single line approach is suitable for medium to large branch operation, meaning branch to the sea floor or the mission
side. I meant, obviously, this workshop solution is we find it useful for close-up applications.
Okay.
If you are increasing your survey range, your X or Y distances, if you want to cover larger areas, then I believe that one line.
Yeah, there's another question I have, because if you are using the one-line system, the problem you have is that there is no overlap between one line and the next.
Yes.
Well, there may be overlap, but that's not usable. So you have to build these submaps. But using the one-shot 3D reconstruction, there would be overlap between one measurement and the next, and that would be better. That wouldn't allow for larger missions.
That is true, and a work that we couldn't achieve actually. Because when we tried to mount this system in a real AUV scenario, and we went physically to find the Mosa with some people here, we were looking at our sub in dark night, and we couldn't see the laser on the Mosa. So the absorption in there was very noticeable, and we could not work and progress forward.
So that's because the light power, when you have the diffractive optical element, is divided by 25.
Not only is divided by 25, but also the POE has a very low efficiency in transmitting the light. Which essentially is like, what do you call it? If we were to look through the microscope and see how it is made, I don't know, certainly, maybe there are some really tiny slits carved in the lens, and that's what we see. So actually we are limiting the amount of light that transverses the field.
Okay. I'm not sure that it's probably a typo, but I think that you have in one of the equations, that's in page 44, that there is one term missing. That's equation 3.29.
44, you said, sorry?
Yes. But maybe it's, I'm not, maybe it's me, or maybe there is a typo, just to be sure. Will you show in the equations? Yeah, it was in the presentation. Yeah, so basically, where is U? Is something shouldn't be in the zoom, or it's me that. So the image IL has a U parameter. So
yes.
You are integrating over a set of rows. But
yeah. So you have a row and a column.
Yeah.
So the question is for a particular row. So that should be G of a particular
U. Okay, so it's an external parameter in there, G.
We will do this design with the integral for each column.
Okay, so now I get it. Well, have you probably have considered, but just to be sure on how would you do, correcting the submaps when using the G2O framework? Mm-hmm. I mean, you have the correction, the corrected graph, so could you use, do you think you could use the corrected graph to correct the submaps within the submaps, each of the navigation estimations within the submap to propagate somehow the correction to each of the navigation estimates?
Potentially, you could rerun the path of the robot. Yeah. In the end, you have to have something, some element to be completely, I would say, solid or non-movable to be able to find closures.
Yeah.
And by making them smaller, you're actually increasing your chances of not finding matches.
Yeah. Well, I meant something like, when you have the corrected motion from one frame to the other, propagating this motion through the set of smaller motions that you don't disturb, but they could be stored between each of the slots. I don't really know if that could be a good thing to do. Yeah. I'm just not following any particular order, but in the experience where you showed the Dead reckoning seems to be extremely biased. Was it because of the problem with the dead reckoning estimator, or the order currents, or?
We found later afterwards that one of the beams of the DVL was not working or was properly connected.
Okay.
And that might be the reason why this is extremely biased.
Yeah.
That can be one of the reasons. Another reason is we were navigating in very shallow water with a very rocky bottom. So that's the worst scenario you can have where you can find multiple echoes from a very close range.
Okay, and just for the sake of curiosity, given this photometry, where did the system found the loops to achieve what you have with the EF, for example? Where are the loops? In the
odometry? True. This solution?
Yes.
Is that reckoning just using media that you need on
This is the starting point, and then the system finds loops and achieves the correction. So where are the loops?
Well, BKF term here is fusing to the USB location.
Oh, okay. Fine.
Yes.
And very difficult to find loops over there.
Okay.
So there is another thing that sometimes surprised me, and this, I can understand that it's very difficult to have a ground truth in these kind of scenarios, but how confident are you in the metrics that you have used?
Well, I agree with the biography, and so far the few articles that have evaluated some solutions using bathymetry, either using laser or multi-view, they tend to use this consistency-based evaluation as a metric. Assess how well you overlap within yourself.
Okay.
Otherwise, without ground truth, there's hardly anything you can do. And even with this metric, and even if it's established, it can have like false positives.
Yeah.
One shown here. The reason being, there's no overlap, or hardly no overlap in this scenario. So I think the solution would be to have the long submersible hanger, where we can drink everything out of water, scan it with a liner, and then submerge everything, and then conserve it with a vehicle. But separable to the ocean is very expensive and inaccessible.
Yes, okay. There is also a curiosity. You have in the reconstruction you made in the pool, there are some strange things. For example, did the pyramids the pyramid is metallic, I think.
Yeah.
So there are problems with the reflections of the laser. Haven't you detected any kind of problems because of that?
It was metallic, yeah. It doesn't look that.
It seems quite reflective.
I think it was it was quite polished. Brush. So it was not shiny like a mirror.
Maybe the brush. When I saw this image, I thought that the pattern was the checkerboard. Perfected. Okay.
No.
Okay. So there is another thing, and it's for this white box. I think you said that stereoscopy wasn't able to find matches or something.
Yes. So but when you have a stereo camera looking at this white pipe, the block match of stereo algorithm kind of find any similarities between the left and right image.
Yes.
It finds the edge of the pipe, and that's it.
But the 3D reconstruction you showed seems perfect. And and you have the box, but you have a problem with the laser where you're using these stripes.
Yeah, the empty stripe are caused by the limited field of view of the laser.
Oh. Okay.
So
but you have shadows below.
Yeah, that's because the passes of the survey were overlapping on the floor, but were not overlapping. One of the limitations of this diffractive optical element was that the field of view was 19 degrees, which is very narrow compared to the Campos system, which was 16 degrees.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There are some parameters that you use, like this one, to be sure. You probably have obtained them experimentally. For example, you see that when you do submap SLAM, you force that two patches that are not separated at least five patches are not considered.
Yeah.
So the five has been obtained experimentally.
Experimentally, that means the number of patches that. The reason behind is I don't want them to try to match within a corner.
And why not?
Because I find sometimes that they are better in corners to bake pitches and ropes.
Mm-hmm.
The navigation is not really good.
Okay.
So it might become it might end up as a wrong enclosure.
And the other numbers you use that minimum number of frames to build a patch and the maximum travel distance. So I guess
these are related to the uncertainty in the navigation and the maximum size of the patch.
Okay, but these are fixed numbers that you decide for every mission. Okay. And just a few more questions. What are the advantages of the helix pattern calibration in front of the other pipe? If you use one case, the checkerboard and then the helix pattern?
Well, the limitations of the checkerboard calibration are that you actually need the ideal scenario of having your AUV stable at a fixed depth, no movement with very good lining, so that you are able to detect the chest, the checkerboard pattern, and the laser at the same time, in the same field of view, and in the same plane.
So that couldn't be done with the Falcor.
So that couldn't be done with the Falcor. I did some sensor vibrations in Girona, for instance, when we were there doing some experiments, and then I made them here in the UAV by holding the vehicle on top of the crane, out of water, actually, and finding the coordinates of the laser. With respect to the camera out of water and dimensions and the same, because I'm not moving the laser of the camera. So I calibrate the camera out of water, by the plane, calibrate the camera into water, and then use that.
So, in a perfect world where you have all the resources available, probably the checkerboard is better than the other one that you can have.
Well, the other one has the benefit of being repeatable at the beginning of each dive. So, if you are to go to the ocean, you can calibrate it. It doesn't put any overhead in mission time or in cost of calibration. Just to perform a helix pattern, which you need to do while going in the water.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. And another thing that you mentioned is that when you increase the water turbidity with milk, there is a point in which the 3D reconstruction goes from something that is quite good to something that is 70 points, I think. Mm-hmm. So this drop, could it be related to some threshold you have in your algorithms?
Well,
because it is a very large drop, I mean, you go from something that is reasonable to nothing.
Nine. So if you look at the image, I mean, I couldn't tweak the camera parameters to any to any point where I could see the lines even myself.
Yeah. No, I mean only that in the experiment 7, for example, and in experiment 9, visually I see more or less the same, but the reconstruction is quite different. So, yeah, maybe there are some parameters. But
maybe there are some parameters.
Yeah. And well, I had some question related to why you stop the state vector of the Kalman filter into the acceleration of including the angular accelerations, but then I have seen that you've properly explained it with some references and so on, so that's the standard way of doing these things. Okay. So just is more quiet. The distance of the bottom in Valdemosa was 1.5 meters and 8 meters in the outcrop.
The camera systems are completely different.
Oh.
Yeah. So
and the water conditions?
Sorry?
The water conditions were similar?
The water conditions, yeah. So it was clear waters.
Okay, so that's the camera.
Yeah, well, there's a couple of things. So the system used in Falkor was using a different camera, which is a Luminera, which is a scientific CMOS camera, which is far more sensitive to the light. And laser power is similar, it's the same, but in Falkor, I think we are continuously firing the laser, so it's on throughout all the tissue, whereas in Falkor we are pulsing it, and by pulsing it you can stretch a little bit more.
Okay,
yeah.
And the last thing is that the particle filter, you use the particle filter with 50 particles?
Yes.
That's
very,
very small number.
That's a very small number. So to process, for instance, file for data set, which was 350 into 150, with 50 particles.
How many meters?
50 millimeters, 350 by 150.
Ah.
The resolution of 7 millimeters.
Yeah.
I'm saying the number off of my head. But it was a resolution in the order of less than 1 centimeter.
Mm-hmm.
So if you start multiplying that by the number of particles, then the amount of memory you need at every this sampling step starts becoming quite huge.
Mm-hmm.
And I started progressing towards the number of particles, and when I reached 100 particles, with the resolution campus. Freezing constantly.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, yes, that's a problem with particle filters.
So the memory has to be treated in another way to increase the number of particles.
Yeah.
But yeah, I agree with you that it's a very limited number.
Yes. Okay. So I don't think I don't have any other questions. Well, this kind of one. Have you considered using something different to ICP?
I tried a couple of different things. I even have a publication in AV using another type of registration where I implemented registration myself. However, ICP is already an established method.
Yes.
And this second approach is generalized ICP, really accounted for all the differences that I was trying to implement myself.
Best approach that we have tested. Well, there are some other ones that could be better, but the computational cost is also important, as I mentioned. So, okay, so thank you very much. These were all my questions. And again, congratulations for this excellent work, excellent presentation, and excellent research. And there's something that you just mentioned at the very end, but it is also important, that is the fact that it is not easy to do this kind of experiments in underwater robotics.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not been working with the data set, we have been working with real data to deal with the problems of going with the robot to the sea and this kind of stuff, and this is very important to take into account. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
So, Pep,
yeah.
The time to return to
the session. So, Miguel, first of all, I would really, my will is to really congratulate you for the huge work that you've done. It's huge because I know how many countless hours there must be, not only behind your the search of documentation and everything, but behind the experimentation that you've done. It's been quite surprising when I started to read that and I started to figure out what you've done. Come on, it can't be true. But no, I trust you. It's true, of course. actually, a comment about the amount of how many publications you have. It was surprising to see that you have a section called unrelated publications. And to see that you almost have more unrelated publications than related publications.
That's true.
So that tells a lot. And actually not so much unrelated publication, because they have to do with the underwater environment. There's a whole lot of them. So for that very, I really have to congratulate you as well for that. Right. So congratulations said, I have a few comments. I will try to keep myself a little bit shorter in questions. But now that you have this slide here, it's just out of curiosity. When you express turbidity in percentage and then you give the numbers in rational numbers, is there any reason why? Because I had to calculate in order to see how was the progression.
So the issue here is in the official data, the turbidity in milliliters.
Yeah,
in volume percentage, it might actually tell something. So, yeah, if I tell you, obviously, when I computed the percentage, they were really long and nasty numbers. So, integers with a division in the middle. Like,
if you range it from 0.4 to 2.3 or 2.6 or something like that percent.
That's right.
Or less. The percentage of turbidity.
Yeah.
Range from 0.4 to 2 point something in the nine, is it?
Yeah.
So there's actually compression.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I'm going to interject here, rather repeating the question later.
All right.
So what do you mean by turbidity percentage? Is the percentage of milk per
liter? The volume.
That doesn't really mean anything. I mean, it's not a turbidity index. It's a percentage of milk per volume. So if I want to compare to somebody else and we've done some experiments, unless he uses milk as well, it's an important point, I think. I think one thing you could have done, and I'm not asking you to do it, is shine your laser through the various quantities.
All right.
You know the power of the laser, and you put the receiver at different depths.
Yeah,
that
gives
you the attenuation per liter.
Yeah.
That's a number that can be repeated across milk, whatever you put in.
That's
something, because in fact, that's one of, because I thought that's great, I'm going to be able to compare with what we do. And then I looked at the number, and I, unless I put milk, I can't do it.
One of the, actually, one of the external reviews of the PhD suggested to put these in NTU units, and then I was trying to find out the conversion between milk and NTU units.
Yeah, exactly. So attenuation events or something, a real physical parameter would have been a bit better than this. I think you could have done it at the time. I'm not asking you to do it.
It's not very difficult to repeat because you have to fill a pipe.
I'm not asking you to do it for the
time. Yeah, I see your point.
But it's something that would be useful.
Yes. The other, well, there. I have lots of notes here to comment. I would like first to comment about the laser detection.
Yes.
You go for the laser detection. At some point, you say that first derivative is not possible to be used or not suitable for underwater applications, but you mentioned that the windowing was the Gaussian approximation is, but could you explain a little bit why the fear was first derivative is not suitable for underwater?
So and we were both doing research in this line.
Yeah.
And I don't remember from the top of my head the reason behind it, but we found both solutions.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And we both agreed in this one. It was quite fascinating in doing okay. Whereas for the fear, I believe there are some parameters or some other parameters of field that need to be tuned.
Yeah.
And the reason for the fear is actually for known Lambertian surfaces.
No, it's for Lambertian surfaces whatsoever. I mean, for example, here in the underwater application, we applied that method for in 2019 with Balearic. Or already, I mean, we didn't even tweak it. I mean, we used the one that was already implemented in the camera, and we got the results that were. And yeah, I mean, of course, you cannot pretend to use a first derivative without any previous filter, whatever, because otherwise you get peaks everywhere, and then you get a nightmare instead of a detection. But yes, my combined with the fear filter could work. But again, it's a very time consuming. It's very time consuming. Unless you dedicate hardware for that, you can get actual real time unless you optimize it. It's just because I saw it as a bold statement and I said, well, why not?
Yeah, that's true.
That's the thing. Okay, so I mean, if you encountered any problem with the first derivative method, you would certainly encounter a problem with the Gaussian approximation as well, if you don't filter before. So I guess the windowing is a filtering as well.
Yeah, I mean, there's a way of just...
Because it's an integral and then you filter out by integrating.
Okay. So things like, for instance, marine snow get picked up with this type of filter.
Yeah.
But then when you do the integration within the filter,
exactly,
the value will be lesser than this.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And connected to that, when you filter, you get the, let's say, a kind of filtered max value per column.
Yeah.
Or per row.
Per window.
Per window. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, have you tried your method in an environment where scattering plays a role in there? I mean, you get backscatter. I mean, particles in suspension, whatever. You haven't.
Yeah. I have. And it's not showing the case, yeah, it's not showing this presentation,
uh-huh,
but there's also a method I'm providing with Adriac with a bottleneck, for instance, where we look for groups of pixels in the same way as the multiline approach, and we remove all the groups of pixels that are less than a number.
Yeah.
So, for instance, if you were to have a laser shining that is rotating,
mm-hmm,
the length of the pixels that are shining is less than 10-15.
But sometimes it might happen that the best reading comes from a backscatter from a particle than the object itself.
Yeah, because it's closer to the camera.
Yes.
It's pretty exciting. Yeah,
and it happens very often, unfortunately. So that's it's very evident.
And you know, the photo are sometimes...
Yeah. That's why I first moved outside the map. That's weird. Connected to that as well, wouldn't that, maybe for the future work to overcome these problems with backscatter, it's a good idea to try gating the laser together with the imaging. That means that if you measure the time taken by the light to cross,
yep,
and then gating only when the light comes back into the camera, you avoid all the backscatter.
Yeah, absolutely.
Particles.
Yep.
But that requires a very good timing, very good synchronization and everything. The theory is very beautiful,
there's a cost and volume limitation.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
these
exactly.
Systems, they tend not to be very portable, neither are affordable.
Exactly. Well, yeah, it could be affordable, but as you say, there would be a range and a volume limitation. About the, I will speak myself too. I will not do any questions, make any questions about Salam, okay? I will try to speak myself into my knowledge. And, but just a comment about the, when you, or a question, for decoding, when you use your one shot.
Yeah.
It works very well. But when you keep your center dot here.
Yes.
This you use it as a reference for further decoding, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it might happen that this dot gets occluded by something in a number of successive
yes.
or consecutive frames.
Yeah. That's the ways of labeling.
Okay.
The easier one, as you said, is finding the central dot.
Mm-hmm.
The second one is finding your 25 line crossings.
Okay. By using the graph.
Yes. If both are found, there's a voting
okay.
system that counts for how many pixels do I bring in this voting. And then I take the most reliable source of information.
Okay. Still impressive to see how a symmetrically projected grating gets decoded in a very consistent way. It's really good to see. When you compare your point cloud, I don't know which, and in your dissertation, here, when you do these comparisons, and that you very well pointed out that when the stereo doesn't find matchings, then you get huge errors.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you, I assume that you are comparing locally. The objects,
yeah.
And I mean the background does not actually have any interest in the comparison, at least in my view. But if you compare objects to objects, and what you do is to align the reconstruction using stereo with the reconstruction using laser, have you maybe would be a better idea to compare both the stereo and the laser with some kind of artificially obtained point cloud, because you have the designs of all those.
Well, that's
maybe not the eyes, but the pyramid. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
When you show the ground truth, is this what you have done?
No. These are measurements taken with the tape.
These are measurements.
Yeah. Not with the point cloud. Yeah, that's true. That's the point. Yeah.
I mean, sampling the step or the IGF or something like that. That is, in the reality, then what is manufactured doesn't have to do with the design, okay? But maybe the comparison would have been better. One of the questions were asked by Tony: Why do we get those fringes in the reconstruction? Why are there those blank spaces, especially in the square pipe?
Yeah.
So why do you subtract the red channel?
Well, I found that the background illumination was very well fixed with the red channel.
Okay.
So, for instance,
in all experiments, or do you think in deep ocean this will happen too? Or because the laser is green, actually.
The laser is green. Yeah. I was doing experiments in here, it was in here, but and I had to kindly ask everybody to stand up with the lights off for a moment. So I had some ambient light in there, and I think curve on the bottom here tells for the ambient light. So in order to remove this non-linear lighting from the background, okay.
So that is something rather localized for the experiments you did, rather than something that is generally advisable. Yeah.
So obviously, if you go below, say, 50 meters,
yeah,
there is hardly no light.
Yeah,
light
at all.
It's a one and red light unless your laser is very sharp.
Okay. About, you mentioned that you got more error when reconstructing with the laser,
yeah,
than with the stereo vision.
Yes.
System.
Yeah.
Okay. But lighting in both cases has a big role here. For example, the intensity of the laser.
Yeah.
If it's low,
yeah,
then the stereo will win for sure. If you have a low lighting for the stereo, thus the laser strike will win. That's
well, I tried to play fair, so the light was off for the laser, the light was off for the stereo. Yeah.
Okay.
That's why, for instance, the image that you see here, the lighting is quite homogeneous, and the three reconstruction is the same.
Yeah.
So it's very well lit.
Yeah. Okay. So you tried yourself to
try to play fair,
to put enough light everywhere, and still you got that. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. It's a bit surprising. I've had a lot of experience, but not in the field, not in underwater environments, I have to say that, but in the industry. actually the laser scanning is, if it has some pro against the stereo, is the accuracy.
Yeah, well, obviously when you work to compute shape, given that the laser is inherently sparse, you actually don't have all the points that you would like to make some measurements. So actually, when you have to pinpoint yourself to make a measurement, you may pick up a point that actually has a spine
that exists
to the end of the object.
Yeah.
So that may be one of the sources of error. So and the other one has to do with the baseline between the laser and the camera, obviously the larger it is, the better the video reference.
Okay, so the resolution of the laser projector has a lot to do with it here as well. Okay. Last curiosity, what is the blue laser wavelength that you use on board of the robot?
On the robot it was 420, I believe. Okay. Right.
And what power? Because underwater I think
one,
it's
one watt.
One watt.
One watt.
Yeah, yeah.
So this unit was handmade from a guy in Tokyo. And it's more like an artist than a scientist.
Yeah. And there finally when you say that when you put things underwater and you have a viewport in the middle, there is a refraction involved and so forth. So I guess, that plays a big role in the whole process. One comment that you say is that you assume that the laser light comes out of the optics in a normal direction.
Yeah, which is not completely true for the 3.5
mm. Exactly.
And I had a really nice discussion with Greg Palavere about that.
Right.
Where he was speaking to me about the cone fitting of the laser planes.
Yeah.
For the limited fine field of view, it's not quite very noticeable.
Okay.
However, it is true that these lines actually don't belong to the
And sometimes, I mean, I guess the craft-made laser that you have used was brilliantly aligned, but more often than you would expect, manufacturers come out with something that you would expect the laser from going this direction, and actually goes that direction, and that's a manufacturer flaw. Yeah, I mean, and when you go for refraction, sometimes it makes you redesign and remake everything just for that particular laser.
So in the last school I've been involved, we have been using the system with domed lasers.
Okay.
And that made our
life better.
Yeah. No.
Really?
It works. Yeah, because when you place the laser plane and it is not centered within the dome, then we have found that it's not a cone surface anymore.
Yeah.
So we have to
make the viewport. Okay, I think I will skip the other 1,000 questions for maybe later in the dinner.
Yeah,
Thank you. Thanks again.
Thank you very much, Pep. So, last one standing. I want to congratulate you as well for post the presentation and the work. I think having worked in such a robotics for 20 years now, I know how hard it is to actually work in this environment. So you've been brave, I think, to try. And you've actually used a lot of real data. Do not confine yourself to the safety of a small tank where you can control everything. And that's really quite nice. And the thing is very well written. It was a pleasure to read it. There's a few things that I have in the thesis, but so I want to ask you first One big general question. So when you started, you said, I want to do better 3D in the water.
Yes.
Is that what we can do at the moment, I guess? So your idea was, let's do something better. And one of the first things you say in your thesis is, underwater cameras are not very good because of scattering and absorption. But then you use a system that was both a camera and a laser.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So, in a way, you're already saying, okay, cameras are bad, but I'm going to use one. So, but you're using an active system as opposed to a passive system.
Yes.
And therefore, you would expect that using an active system gives you an advantage.
Yeah.
In terms of, because you can control the lighting, so you control the wavelengths, mm-hmm. you control. But your camera is an RGB camera.
In some data sets, it is.
Sorry?
In some data sets, it is. So, Toolbot's data set was an RGB camera. In Hyperpitch, it is a monochrome camera.
So, did you optimize the camera, the choice of the camera?
No.
To the source? So see, I mean.
So, the only thing I did was to be just a little bit smarter on how did I weight the channels of the RGB camera.
But why not use an optical filter on reception? Get
yeah.
rid of everything else in terms of your weather.
We tried that. We actually purchased one filter as a bandpass at the same wavelength of the laser. However, if the incoming light is not strictly perpendicular to the filter, that is also cut out.
But that's a filter problem. But I mean, conceptually, it would solve all of the problem removing the red channel. You would just have the light, because that's all you're interested in, right?
You want
the best light possible.
Yeah.
So you did try the filter.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine. Again, all you're interested in the camera is the best contrast possible.
Yes.
So do you use a very low light camera, or do you use?
Through what data set we used a camera that was available for a stereo system.
Yeah.
And for the data set is a camera that is very low light and very sensitive.
Okay, and then you did all the work with the diamond, you get to the 3D. And it feels a bit like you've done it, you compare to stereo, you went, well, it's about the same. I'm gonna stop that and move to the side. You know, it feels there was so much to do still in that area, and you kind of stopped.
Why? Yeah, it may seem like that. We tried, as I said before to Tony, we tried to put the system on a real platform underwater, and the loss of power was so drastic that we couldn't sense. We couldn't see either with the rear eye, we couldn't see the laser underwater. So we couldn't move forward.
Okay, so
in that area. So it was a limitation in terms of hardware and the top of experimentation. So there's obviously room for improvement there.
Yeah. But you could have explored seeing that purely active. You get rid of the camera and you just get the photoreceptor or something, which gives you more sensitivity. Because effectively it's a sensitivity problem, right?
Yeah.
So there's some active system like CD at depth, but there's a pulse. And then they do much filtering and they are very low. Signal to noise ratio, they can still pick up the signal. So I've got, if you look at your graph where you've got lidar versus stereo, you've got right at the beginning, you're presenting here, yes. So lidar, you say it's about 1 decimeter or something like that. You seem to cut lidar at, I mean, I think I know lidars can do underwater. Millimeters.
Yeah.
If you're close enough with the lidar, you can do very high resolution.
I'm accounting for airborne lidar.
Ah, it's airborne lidar.
Airborne lidar.
Ah, because it feels like lidar is just not very good.
No, these are the examples I was showing. So this is airborne lidar.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
And this is airborne lidar.
Yes.
For mine.
So lidar actually can do very well. The problem with lidar is because you're scanning, it takes a long time. Also, seeing that shading in that domain.
Mm-hmm.
So, I've got one comment question on the comparison. When you compare the stereo and super tacking up, you look purely at resolution, but as the two of them have pointed out, there's some missing data in the 3D.
Yeah.
So I think completeness of reconstruction would also, is also an important parameter. Mm. So how much of the structure are they reconstructed? Because what your graph is saying is where reconstructed, the error are about the same.
Mm-hmm.
But it feels like the lidar that you have is reconstructing only partially the structure. While the stereo seems to do a better job at fully reconstructing.
Mm. Yeah, well, it was in a way, it's a limitation on the field of view. So you could have, I could have made the passes.
But you're controlling the trajectory. So
yeah, it was a, true. So,
so can you just comment how complete was the reconstruction stereo versus?
So I would say for the bottom of the pool, we can see that the reconstruction here is narrower, as I couldn't move the structure neither leftwards or rightwards, as the ability was limited. So I would say that's about, I don't know, 80% of the plot. And then from the objects, nearly between 60 and 80% of the object, probably. So had I made the passes more closer to each other, I would have covered the objects completely.
So and then you go and you try your system in turbid water.
Mm-hmm.
And we've already discussed the turbidity. Now, I think your system still has an advantage against stereo,
mm-hmm.
the fact you're projecting a pattern.
Yes.
So you would hope it's better at recognizing that pattern in turbid water than it is with a stereo system.
Mm-hmm.
But you haven't tried a stereo system in the milk.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I mean? It would have been nice to see your system against a stereo through turbid water. And then I suspect you would have been able to show that the stereo system dies way before your system. And therefore, even if you forget the fact the reconstruction is not as complete and it's not as precise, it works at longer ranges or in more turbid water. So you're underselling, I think, the capabilities of your system by not doing the full analysis.
Yeah. For a complete, I would say I had the stereo system just below the laser camera.
Yeah.
I tried to do the reconstruction, and the only thing I got was the reconstruction at the beginning, and then afterwards after. Fine.
Put that in the table. That's effectively what I've just said. The stereo doesn't work at all, even in very low turbidity area. So your system is much better in turbid water, which is what you designed it for at the beginning. But you didn't tell it, you almost proved it.
Stop
trying. Because it's quite an important factor, this. And I think the optics can be optimized if you add filters and took a low sensitivity light. But I don't think the sensor is dead. It feels like you went for the multi shot and you went, oh, I can't see. I think there's still some work that you could do on this.
And
if you combine it with a scanning system like the one that your animal does, having multiple lines plus the scanning means you could have very, very high resolution. I think it's a good system.
Mm-hmm.
And it feels when you presented it, you went, well, it's okay, but I moved to multi, to slam on the single beam.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you undersold a bit the system. I think it's much better than you make it.
Okay. Thank you.
Now let's move on to slam. I only have a couple of questions.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you create your graph? Because you're not using overlapping submaps to create the graph. You only use the graph, the submap for loop closure.
Yeah. So I'm building submaps. I'm building the submaps with compounding movement and laser lines.
So what are the edges of your graph while you're doing this? Just that reckoning?
Yes.
Okay. So you use that reckoning to create. But you could have created a submap, creating an overlapping submap, and use ICP to create another edge. You've got the dead reckoning and you've got the ICP. And you keep
doing
this.
Use
the loop closure as well.
I tried that as well.
Oh, you did try.
I did try. Like making, there's lots of pricing behind it. So
But it's really important to know what works and what doesn't work. Because if it doesn't work, it's quite important. I'm not going to try the game.
Yeah, I see. So the problem is, I tried having interleaved lines. So having a samba, for instance, imagine a samba with elements.
Yeah.
And we say the first or the last five. Actually, I put one line for the next samba, and then I take one of this one, the next one for the next samba, and I take one of this one. So we interleave the maps, and then we try to reduce them. But actually, we use that reckoning to make that map. So unless we magically teleport ourselves between lines, the reconstruction won't get any better between lines. Because the self-consistent error within the same frame set is so small that doesn't get picked up, or if it gets picked up, it has to be picked up in an alternative way for you to correct.
Okay, great. So if you go back to your the one where you have the comparison between KFs of that.
This one?
No, the one where you compare the results.
Yeah.
Keep going. So I got really confused during the presentation. And then you clarify your KF is with USBL.
USBL.
But the one on the right, do you also use USBL?
Yes.
So if they use USBL, that means how much of the SLAM is doing the correction, how much is USBL?
Well, to answer that question, I put this figure. So that's the comparison in the robot path.
Yeah.
Comparing the USBL or the EKF solution in red, which lies just behind the sub-ups, and the SLAM, which actually said, I don't agree so much with the USBL.
Okay, and so you expect the CBE to give you the kind of metric to tell you how good the trajectory is?
Yeah.
So, what's the impact of the loop project? I think the When I looked at the thesis and at the presentation, I was thinking, okay, that's really good. But how do I know that the loop closure helps? Where is the proof?
Where is the proof that the loop closure helps?
But we don't really see how many loop closures you have in here.
We're
missing information.
There's not a number, but the I believe in this data set there's six, and they are depicted in black. So that's one here.
Oh, so these are the loop closures.
One here.
So that's not many. So in a way, it's SLAM, but very, very, very few loop closures. So I'm not sure how compelling that is in terms of. And that's where I think maybe for the SLAM part, you could have your simulation, but not just for data. Compare things in a controlled environment, you have truth, you have everything. You can create a map, you can put your laser line on the map, extract the information, add a bit of noise, and try things. So I've asked a question about the project. I'm with Antonio on the number of particles. So have you used the approach that Barclay used in terms of using the inheritance of the particle to reduce the number of requirements?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
So because you use a particle filter,
yes.
Each particle got some ancestors.
Yeah.
So when you build the map,
yeah.
You don't need to store all of the map for each of the particles.
Yeah.
Because your father has got already a map. So you just need to add a little bit.
Yeah.
Which is what you do. So you can reduce the memory.
Yeah.
Barclay has a really nice job at reducing the memory.
Yeah.
So that you could run with lots of particles without this explosion that you see.
Yeah.
I was wondering, did you use the same approach, or did you each particle got the full map?
I did my best in using the same approach. I didn't have access to the code of itself. So I implemented probably manually.
Yeah.
And when I was having these first issues with the particle size and map size, I looked into the numbers, and if we were to look into that, we compare Barclay had a multi-beam days that we have 1920 pixels.
Okay.
Then he was something multibeam at the order of 10 hertz, something similar, and something camera at 20 hertz.
Yeah. So,
if we scale that up, and it's an algorithm of a cubic order, it quickly scales up.
Okay, that's neat. Thank you very much again for the presentation. I think we have done an extensive query of the candidate. Are there any member of the public with a PhD who would like to ask further questions? No? In which case, we thank you very much for attending. We thank Miguel again for the presentation. And if we can ask you to leave, we're going to have to deliberate for. Oh yeah, sorry, I forgot. Maybe the supervisor would like to say a few words.
Okay, thank you, Ivan. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank the panel for all the comments that you gave provide us today. They were very positive, very constructive. I think many of them will be taken into account for a good work. For sure, also some of these comments also have been considered for us before, but well, a thesis is a history. It starts in some moment and the finish is a few years later, and for sure we didn't do the same thing if we started today. So maybe in some cases that can be corrected or improved in the future, but okay, I think that the work is good enough. I only want to say that Miguel has, for me, a very good combination, an unusual good balance between science, technology, and adventure, and it has been demonstrated here, because he is the first to get involved in a cruise, the first to get involved in organizing a Christmas dinner, but the first also to get ready for anything in the lab. So it's very, very important for me having him in the lab. It has been a very good, a pleasure. And well, for sure, I would like him to be back someday. I don't know if we will be able to have the budget to do that. But I'm also happy to know that many people around the world is willing to have him in their labs. So this either is that makes me proud for our, to be in this lab or preparing and doing something well that is also desirable for other people. So, well, I don't know. Just to remark again about the fact that all the data in this thesis has been gathered by Miguel, all they are original, and I know that all of you are know very well how hard it is to get systems working in real environments. So thank you very much again for your comments, and thank you to Miguel for being with us during these years.
Thanks.
Thank you.